Well, it's been an absolutely fascinating morning, at least for me. There are so many crossing over threads and moments of great poetry, beauty, that it's quite difficult to think about how to be most productive with our short amount of time that we have. For me, the relationship between the body, the indexicality of the body within space, and making sense of a mass of a plethora of material pressing on oneself came through very strongly as something to do with how we make sense of our everyday lives, of moments that are sublime, of moments that are mundane, of the repetitiousness of dailiness, and how we recollect this and how we represent it. And I would like to open up to the audience to ask any questions that they would like to address to one of the speakers in particular, or to address to all of us. So I hand over to you. There are roving mics.
I wanted to ask something about the role of humour, irony, even sarcasm, that seemed almost maybe suggested in some of the works. I'm thinking, for example, of the learning how to type. You know, seem to have some sort of relationship to the secretarial and the feminine at that point. Again, I think Amy mentioned a kind of ambivalent riposte / homage to Gertrude Stein in the works that you were talking about. And I think humour's there definitely in your work, both Amy and A.K. Dolman. So I wanted to talk about whether that was a conscious strategy. We think of these as works that are very systematic in many ways, and yet also seem to have a kind of an ironic function that's also a statement of some kind, you know, a personal statement.
Oh, thank you for mentioning humour. I did actually myself a little bit. For me personally, it's really part of my work, but not. And hardly anyone see it, but it's perhaps there as a, yeah, it's a dialogue, it's a conversation with my work, the humor is also how to survive in a way, you have that, you know, it's very, between the very, very serious and the humor, but I just thank you for mentioning it, it's an important part of my work that very few people mention, so thank you.
Yeah, so I think there's in a lot of work, actually not just Bernadette Mayer's but other people too, there's a kind of interesting effect of if you have something serious, right, it often tips in the other direction. And it's a funny thing, often people don't mention it, talk about it when it's the work of women artists and they're thinking, oh, you know, we must take this seriously, which I totally think we entirely must, but we also must take the humour seriously. And sometimes the very idea of like acting something out to an extreme or an excess is particularly funny. And I was actually struck by that watching the films of Anna Mendieta recently. Obviously, Anna Mendieta's films are very often thought of as kind of traumatic and bloody, but sometimes they're kind of comic. And, you know, the kind of blood is so fake, all the things. So I often feel like I'm being very inappropriate laughing at conceptual art by women. And maybe I should think more seriously indeed about that prompt.
I think it's, for me, it's a very interesting sort of turn of events, really, to sort of think about how the sort of how jouissance and the sort of cruelty of this of a certain kind of humour that has come about over the last year and a half. And of course, I think that it's important to say that a lot of what has been revealed has always been the case. So I don't think this is necessarily revelation to many people. But I think there's almost like, Trump is almost like a poultice, drawing out the poison and making visible these really unpleasant sort of behaviours, but also things that people have been thinking for an awfully long time, actually. They just haven't been emboldened to say it. So I think what's useful, though, is this sort of, you know, outpouring of, I'm going to say it anyway now. There's a sort of quality to this. And what that then means, of course, is that people are very identifiable. So with the Charlottesburg incident, those people that went without masks, we now know who they are. That's really important. And I think this is connected very much so with an idea of the sovereign subject sort of having a sense of losing their power, having sort of doubting the, you know, it being doubted whether or not they're any longer at the top of the pile, so to speak. And with that comes this sort of, I think, cruel sort of aspect that runs like a seam through a lot of what's been happening of late. Whitney Phillips has written a fantastic book on a lot of this material. And her comment is that trolling replicates pretty much the casual banter of everyday life anyway. It might be amplified and it might be slightly more alarming when it's operating with many people. But there is something about that is connected to this idea of jouissance, this idea of expression, this idea of the freedom to be able to express oneself as one pleases, that seems like the last cry of the sort of previously privileged subject. It's a very complex topic. I'm not so sort of interested in irony, I have to say. I kind of think that we're a bit sort of beyond that. But
thanks very much. I'd like to draw attention to one of the works that's in the library display. Athena Tasha, when you see the kind of portraits of indexicality faces, I mean, there's irony, there's playfulness, there's humour, there's seriousness very much in that particular work. And with Kozlov's, the relationship between the idea of the typewriter as a sound thing and this incredibly repetitious process that actually becomes a work in itself is kind of sort of distancing oneself from what one is actually doing, reflecting upon it, but becoming something else in the process of doing it, becoming a typist. It's necessarily funny and a bit crazy. I found the film, the Hats film, the subtle humour that is incredibly full of pathos, quite remarkable. This performance that is on a roof that we can kind of recognise as Lower East Side, and then this sort of process of different identities being performed as a sort of repetitious thing. It is funny. It's also quite sad. So I think that these practices do kind of go very close to the mark, very close to the edge, where we have an ambivalence between humour and despair. And it's done in a way which is extraordinarily economical, and it almost happens without us realising that it's happening. Yar, for as long as I can, is one of the most beautiful pieces that I've heard in recent times. And it sort of took me through a whole range of emotional experiences when I heard it, when you performed it a couple of years ago. These experiences are being encountered and processed as part of this durational situation. And I think that that's another thing which is really interesting about the nature of the work that we have been looking at today, is this kind of looping, this looping that combines our relations with the thing that we're experiencing and the work, and it unfolds somehow during that process.
Yeah, I was thinking of that time, something I thought a lot about that. It's one material all these work have together, and that's time, the passage of time as a material on its own, because then that things are really, really serious, and then over time, and then you reach that edge with humor, exactly as beauty, like the romantic German poet says something like, beauty is the beginning of terror that we're still just able to bear. If things are so beautiful, but they have to be, if you're so in love, it's so fantastic, where can it go, you know? You know what the next is. And that's also something with pain or humor. I thought, no, it's a connection there. But then again, time as material, which is interesting common link in all these works. So that was a good comment.
We do have time for another question.
Joe, you mentioned repetition, and I think that repetition is one of the most important aspects of the work this morning. So we saw the repetition of visual images, but also repeated sound and language. And I'm interested in how that repetition works and is structured. So, Joe, you pointed out beautifully that Kozlov's language takes on this sort of sonorous quality through its repetition. And I'm wondering, A.K., in your piece, Ya, how you, so John Giorno's repetition, his pronouncements of Ya were, he manipulated the time of Ya, and you manipulated the pitch, the topography of your prosody. So I'm wondering how, if you had planned that, because he creates a sort of ostinato that you, and you have these beautiful interludes. So I'm wondering how you structured that, or Amy and AK, how you both created those repetitive structures in your work, and you know, how that's structured.
Yeah. In a way, I think I explained we didn't structure it. That was a strange thing. I just went to the studio, and I was the first one, and when I heard my own voice, I didn't even know they recorded it then. But I came into this, ooh. Yeah, in my language, we say also this funny, yeah, you breathe in, we do with the, it's all this, and one thing just led to another. And then John, as a Buddhist, he started very kind of, you know, yeah, 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 he's strong and he's training his voice every day. But then he was taken by something with the repetition as well. So he also started to wander in a way, like a conversation there and then. So it wasn't structured. We put that on top of each other and went out and had a nice lunch and a walk. And continued talking, so actually it wasn't structured. After flying all the way from above the Arctic and all the way there, hire a very expensive studio and the editor, and then we just walked out. So it was something that the repetition, or not the repetition, but that travel kind of took us, both of us. If that was an answer.
I think it's also, it's very interesting that you were walking, and that you spend quite a lot of time walking, because that sort of pacing, thinking, walking, rhythmic repetition, perhaps punctuates, without being sort of deliberately present there. But that space of time that it takes for you to get to wherever you're having lunch, or to get to wherever you're going, somehow is kind of a compression, or compressed in another situation.
Like walking up to the lake in the mountain, it's very steep, and you walk and you walk. That's also time as material again. What should I write in this? Well, this is sound work, but it's the time, it's the walking, it's so much that we are not used to perhaps. ripen what does this work consist of. Many of these work, we have to look at again the material in a different way, I think. It's been very interesting.
I think I'd just say something just that comes to mind as we're talking about time is something that Mayer's work helped me think about is this difference between a proposition that involves a process and a prolonged process that's split up over time, so this kind of durational event, and the historical moment and history. So the difference between what it would have been to look at and experience that work when it was shown in 1972 and how it's different when we encounter it now, if we indeed do. And you know, one of the critics of this piece, you know, the one who I read out, said they're all overexposed or underexposed, they're not quite right, they're not quite good photography. She then goes on to say, oh, it's, you know, it's a period style. And of course it wasn't a period style in like 1972. So I'm thinking about, you know, how one as a reader of the work thinks about history and one's own relationship to Bernadette Mayer's memory or your own kind of research, right? So these kind of layers of the way that time, history and memory kind of interweave through that work now when we encounter it. And I think that's also something that's an interesting proposition when we're thinking about these historic conceptual pieces or how they last in the mind.
Thanks for that question. My whole practice basically is about repetition. So I've sort of, in each of the works that I've sort of showed you, I'm sort of testing out basically, they're sort of like experiments with different forms of how we think about difference and repetition, the ways in which we can see that sort of happening in finance perhaps. Ayash's work is very much about how to engage the dynamic replication of the Black-Scholes-Merton model. So we might sort of see these as, if we want to think about absurdity, we might see these as absurd sort of degrees of repetitious behaviours. And my interest is how do I work within that mix? What am I in that mix? How do I sort of operate to a degree? The error correction script is repeated over and over and over again. I mean, you know, however long I last, I shall still be doing this as a re-editing process each time around. And Learnable Spirits, of course, is really an extreme, an absurd version of difference for the sake of difference, repetition for the sake of, it's just an extraordinarily extreme operation that's just, and it becomes really just trading for the sake of trading. It is pure process. And there was something very interesting in relation to what we were thinking about in terms of a sort of conceptual practice and what that would, how that changes the socio-political sort of environment that we are acting in today, perhaps in relation to historical practices.
Thanks very much. Yes, a feeling of incredible persistence. I'd like to change the pitch. There is lunch served in the Red Room, so you all go and get a good lunch and come back at a 2 o'clock start. And plenty of time for informal conversations and also to see the two exhibitions.